praise to God for Jesus as she had been and was and will forever be divinely blessed. That is, divinely blessed in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. Magnificent is the first word in the Latin translation. And it means simply to magnify. It speaks of magnifying God or glorifying God. You see in verse 46 the words, "And Mary said," and that's the Greek word for saying aloud. She was vocal with it. "And Mary said, my soul magnifies." The word "my" indicates that this musical, if you will, it's a very personal thing. "Soul" indicates that it's felt deep down. "My soul magnifies." That word means to declare the greatness of. And that was her purpose, to declare the greatness of God the Father and certainly God the Son. Verse 46, "And Mary said, my soul magnifies the Lord." Thus we come to the purpose of all Christmas musicals, of the one this morning, the one week from tonight. Always it is to glorify God in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ, to magnify His name, to magnify His spiritual kingdom, to magnify everything that comes under the banner of God the Father. The Magnificent is one of four Christmas musicals recorded in Luke, in the Gospel according to Luke. The hills of Judea, called in verse 39, the hill country. The Judean hill country certainly did come alive with the sound of music. Not just any music, but Christmas music. Not sung by Julie Andrews, but sung by Mary. Luke chapter 1, verses 46 through 55. That's Mary to Elizabeth, and possibly others were listening in as well, called the Magnificent, because it magnifies God in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. And yet there was a second musical in Luke chapter 1, verses 68 through 79, by Zacharias, the priest and aged father of John the Baptist, called the Benedictus. He was struck, Zacharias was struck speechless because of his unbelief about the birth of his son, John the Baptist, and was unable to give the benediction when he was ministering in the temple because God struck him speechless. That very story is right here in Luke chapter 1, verses 5 through 25. But now, at this point, he has his voice back. At chapter 1, verses 68 through 79, his voice has returned, and he's able to give the benediction. He was not able to earlier, but now he gives the benediction at the circumcision of John, the forerunner of Christ, in the form of an inspiring Christmas musical about Messiah. So the first musical is in chapter 1, verses 46 through 55. The second one in chapter 1, verses 68 through 79. Then there's a third one, and it is very, very brief. It is the angels to the shepherds. Chapter 2, the musical, is in verse 14. Let's read verse 13 as well. "And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly hosts, praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men." And so there's the third musical. Probably it is better described a chorus, which we think of a chorus as being a very brief hymn or very brief song. It was spoken more than being sung. It was apparently not a full Italian cantata, but it did accomplish its mission. And its mission was getting the shepherds to come to Jesus. So once again, the purpose of any Christmas chorus, the purpose of any Christmas musical, the purpose of any Christmas program or cantata or message or lesson or conversation is to call people to the Lord Jesus Christ. If we are inspired thereby, that's absolutely wonderful. I would trust that God would be magnified thereby. That's absolutely wonderful. But the purpose of this third Christmas musical in the Gospel according to Luke is to draw people to Jesus. The fourth and final one is in Luke chapter 2, verses 29 through 32. It is of Simeon sung to the people in the temple at the circumcision of Christ. It is called the Nunc Dimittis because that's the Latin translation of the song. And it too is a song, a Christmas song, magnifying God. Well, the Magnificat was 3 points. The Magnificat was, in the first place, a musical in a setting designed by God. This morning, Brother Allen mentioned the poinsettias just behind me being the work of Vicki Shoemake, and God bless Vicki for all that she does. Jason, of course, helped her with the wreaths that are back up on the wall, and I mentioned earlier others who had decorated the church building and done such a wonderful job. Well, in the Magnifica, the setting was designed by God. A musical, if only the lyrics, in a setting, a stage, a scene designed by God. Mary, in the musical, has just learned about her extraordinary pregnancy. That takes place in Luke chapter 1. Let's begin reading at verse 35. And the angel answered and said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Highest will overshadow you. Therefore also that Holy One who is to be born will be called the Son of God. Now indeed, Elizabeth, your relative, has also conceived a son in her old age, and this is now the 6th month for her who was called barren. For with God nothing will be impossible." Then Mary said, "Behold the maidservant of the Lord, let it be to me according to your word." And the angel departed from her, and soon thereafter she makes this visit to the hill country of Judea to visit with her relative Elizabeth. She prepares immediately to take the journey. Can't happen overnight, because this essentially would be an arranged journey. Mary is just a teenage girl, and her family members are not going to allow her to just leave Nazareth on a 2 or 3 day journey and go to the hill country of Judea unattended. So she's going to travel with some people, and there's going to be some preparations to take place. She's going to go to Judea, at least a 40-mile journey, to visit her relative Elizabeth, who lives somewhere in the Judean hills with her priest's husband named Zacharias. Now, Zacharias can't talk at the time, which is, if you can't talk, that's a pretty good time not to talk, because he's most likely going to have a little bit of trouble getting a word in edgewise between Elizabeth and Mary anyway. But he can't talk at the time. And so the two mothers-to-be are going to visit for 3 months at least. Elizabeth, the mother of John the Baptist, and Mary, the soon-to-be mother of Jesus. And as they visit, they will do so in a spirit of humility. And these are the qualities I hope that we can pick up on tonight and incorporate into our own Christmas experience. Elizabeth and Mary are going to visit with one another in a spirit of humility, in a spirit of meekness, in a spirit of dedication, and in a spirit of faith. Why is that? Because they recognize that they have been divinely blessed, and they are acknowledging that truth. One is on the younger side, one is on the older side. With that in mind, let's pick up now, please, at Luke chapter 1 in verse 39. Now, Mary arose in those days and went into the hill country with haste to a city of Judah, and entered the house of Zacharias and greeted Elizabeth. And it happened, when Elizabeth heard the greeting of Mary, that the babe leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. Then she spoke out with a loud voice and said, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. But why is this granted to me, that the mother of my Lord should come to me? For indeed, as soon as the voice of your greeting sounded in my ears, the babe leaped in my womb for joy. Blessed is she who believed, for there will be a fulfillment of those things which were told her from the Lord." Thus reading Luke chapter 1, verses 39 through 45. I want to highlight some things that you just heard. I'm sure you noticed that the Holy Spirit is present and at work in this text. That's why the point is a musical in a setting designed by God. The Holy Spirit is evidently at work in this text. The Holy Spirit will be present on the day of Pentecost to empower the church to take the gospel to the world. And yet the Holy Spirit is present in Luke chapter 1, orchestrating the birth of Christ, the Savior of the world. So the Holy Spirit is present and at work. This is a setting designed by God. I'm sure you noticed how Elizabeth, the older mother-to-be, in no way condemns Mary, the teenager, about her absolutely unique situation. One of the reasons that she has departed from Nazareth to be in the hill country of Judea for those 3 months was so she wouldn't have to explain again and again and again why a young lady, a teenager, who was merely betrothed, was pregnant with child. But on the part of Elizabeth, the older mother-to-be, she in no way condemns the teenager about her unique situation, but instead Elizabeth believes in Mary, thinks the best of Mary rather than the worst about Mary, and encourages her. And that too is the spirit of Christmas. That's the way that God's people interact with one another. Mary, Elizabeth was a BC-er, and Mary was an AD-er. And I mean by that Elizabeth is going to live most of her life in BC. It's not 1 AD yet. It's soon to be. But it's 4 BC or 6 BC, somewhere right in there. The calendar's a little off. But regardless, Elizabeth spends most of her life in the BC, and Mary's going to spend most of her life in the AD. And they come together, and Elizabeth is not saying under her breath about Mary, "You know she's an AD-er, and they do things a little bit different from us." And for them to be distant to one another, that did not happen. We take notice that the Holy Spirit is present and at work in this story. We notice how Elizabeth, the older mother-to-be, in no way condemns Mary, but encourages the teenager about her absolutely unique situation. I'm sure you notice the emphasis on being blessed. That word appeared 3 times in the verses we just read. They were blessed. They knew it. They recognized it. They acknowledged it, and they lived accordingly. And if we truly want to celebrate Christmas, we too have to recognize that we have been divinely blessed. We need to acknowledge it, and we need to live accordingly. And then there was one other thing that I'm sure you took notice of, and that was the uncontainable joy of the occasion. Our minister of music preached us a little sermon about that, a mini sermon this morning, about joy in the church and joy in the congregation and joy in worship. And sure enough, he's right. It was there, right here in Luke chapter 1, verses 39 through 45. There is uncontainable joy as even John the Baptist, as Elizabeth is filled with the Holy Spirit, and John the Baptist leaps for joy when he hears the voice of Mary. It was, in fact, the Magnificat was, in fact, a musical in a setting designed by God. Absolutely beautiful. We were blessed this morning. I'm sure that we will be blessed 1 week from tonight. But what a musical we find in Luke chapter 1. In the second place, a musical set in Scripture with stanza after stanza about Jesus. In just a moment, we're going to read again verses 46 through 55. In verse 47, listen for the words, God my Savior. Now, theologians have given the song the name Magnificat because it magnifies God, and that has to do with what Mary said in verse 46. But if Mary would have been given an opportunity to title her own musical, she would have most likely chosen the title, God My Savior. She'll say that in verse 47. But also you will see that Mary is a student of the Word. The Magnificat is much like the song of Hannah, the mother of Samuel, recorded in 1 Samuel chapter 2, verses 1 through 10. And Mary apparently was altogether familiar with the song of Hannah because they're very similar. The Magnificat contains 15, get this, 15 Old Testament quotations. Some from the history books of the Old Testament, some from the prophet books of the Old Testament, and some from the poetry books of the Old Testament. So understand first that this teenage girl, as young as she was a student of the Word, and you'll see that in just a moment. This is a musical with stanza after stanza about Jesus or Messiah. You will see that Mary is prepared to praise God. In verse 46, she uses that word magnifies. That she is filled with joy. In verse 47, she will use the word rejoiced. That she is humbled by God's goodness. In verse 48, as she uses the word maidservant. And that she is blessed, divinely blessed, in verse 48, as she uses the word blessed. These are the attitudes with which we sing our Christmas hymns, Christmas musicals, proclaim God's word through Christmas messages. Those are the attitudes: praise, joy, goodness, and divinely blessed. These are the attitudes with which we celebrate Christmas. You will also see that Mary recognizes God's goodness in sending Jesus. In verse 49, she says, He is holy. In verse 50, she says, He is merciful. In verse 51, she says that He is powerful. In verses 52 and 53, she says that He is sovereign. And in verses 54 and 55, He is faithful. Because in verses 46 through 55, as we read those verses again, God is about to fulfill one of His ancient promises, the one that He made to Abraham in Genesis chapter 12 and verse 7. And Mary knows that that promise is about to be fulfilled, and she's praising God for it. Listen for all of that as we read these verses again. And Mary said, My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit has rejoiced in God my Savior. That would be her title most likely. And my spirit has rejoiced in God my Savior, for He has regarded the lowly state of His maidservant. For behold, henceforth all generations will call me blessed. For He who is mighty has done great things for me, and holy is His name. And His mercy is on those who fear Him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with His arm. He has scattered the proud in the imagination of their hearts. He has put down the mighty from their thrones and exalted the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things, and the rich He has sent away empty. He has helped His servant Israel in remembrance of His mercy, as He has spoken to our fathers, to Abraham, and to his seed forever. We don't know about the presentation. And we know about the truth. We know about the lyrics. We know that she's magnifying God, that she's glorifying God. We don't know if she spoke this to Elizabeth and possibly others as poetry, or if she sang this a cappella, or if she accompanied herself on a stringed instrument. But you can see that it is a musical set in Scripture with stanza after stanza about Jesus. It is a musical in a setting designed by God. It is a musical set in Scripture with stanza after stanza about Jesus. And in the third place, and briefly, it is a musical that comes to a conclusion and then gets back to business. Take another look, please, at chapter 1 and verse 56. And Mary remained with her, that is Elizabeth, in the hill country of Judea. And Mary remained with her about 3 months and returned to her house. Mary enjoyed her 3 month or so visit with Elizabeth. She was no doubt encouraged and strengthened thereby. And what a wonderful thing to do for others at Christmas, to encourage people and to strengthen one another in the name of Christ. And then after the birth of John, she returned to her home in Nazareth, listen to this, with the intent of doing what God had called her to do. She was not yet living with Joseph. The verse is careful to say that she returned to her house. She is not yet living with Joseph. But soon she would be traveling to Bethlehem with him to do as God willed. Because earlier on in chapter 1, verse 38, this is what the Bible said that she said, "Behold, the maidservant of the Lord, let it be to me according to your word." The angel Gabriel told her that she would be pregnant with Messiah. She said, "Let it be so." She travels to the hill country of Judea as soon as a trip like that could be arranged. She travels to the hill country of Judea, and she's with Elizabeth, her relative, for those 3 months and maybe a few more days. John the Baptist is born. She returns home to Nazareth, to her house, because right now she is just betrothed. The marriage has not been consummated as husband and wives do. It has not been consummated, not yet. She is betrothed, so she's still living at her house. But it won't be long until it's time to travel to Bethlehem for the birth of the Lord Jesus Christ. A musical that comes to a conclusion and then gets back to business. Mary was not divine. Some religionists might lead you to believe that Mary was divine. She was not divine. And yet she was divinely blessed. And every individual in this building tonight has been divinely blessed. We may choose not to recognize it. We may choose not to acknowledge it. We may choose not to live accordingly. But Mary did choose to recognize it. She did choose to acknowledge it, and she lived accordingly. She was not divine, but she was divinely blessed, and she is worthy of our respect as the Blessed Mother. Some religions would use that expression in reference to Mary. We might shun that expression, but if we shun it, it's needless to do so, because the Bible says that she was blessed on four occasions that we've read tonight, that she's the one blessed by God. That's not to say that she's divine. That's not to say that we should worship Mary. Every time that Mary and Christ are mentioned in the Bible, it is always Christ being mentioned first. You can read that for yourself in the Gospel according to Luke. But she is worthy of our respect as the Blessed Mother, because she was the Blessed Mother, just like you're blessed tonight. Every one of us are in Christ. And to follow her example at Christmas is altogether appropriate. What a visit with this relative, Elizabeth. The sweetness of it, the meekness of it, the strength of it, the encouragement of it, the music filled the hills of Judea about the Lord Jesus Christ. It was altogether scriptural. It was altogether led by the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit was altogether present. And then when it was over, it's back to work. So, let's enjoy Christmas because we too are divinely blessed, and then get busy in doing what God has called us to do. In 2019, just be ready to get busy doing the Lord's work, telling the good news of Jesus Christ to our neighbors, to our relatives, to our fellow workers at work, fellow students. Just enjoy it and then get busy for the Lord. Would you stand, please, for the invitation as Brother Allen comes to lead us? If you need to come forward to be saved, to unite with Magnolia Church, to pray in the altar, whatever it may be that God would lead you to do tonight, would you do so as you're led by the Holy Spirit? You need to come to Christ tonight. If so, come and let Jesus have His way in your life. Would you come as we sing one other stanza? Nobody comes on this stanza, we'll close. But let Jesus have His way in your life tonight. If you need to pray in the altar, it's open. If you need to unite with Magnolia Church or trust Christ as your Savior, then come and let Jesus have His way. Mentioned earlier in the service about how tired the children would be tonight and how tired Jason would be tonight, and yet I know all of you have been at it long and hard over the course of this day. And as we were coming to church tonight, I told Terry that we might be at an all-time low tonight because of all the things that have happened today and all the activities, but you're here, and God bless you for your presence. I hope that you'll come on Wednesday night. We're having a good time on Wednesday nights at Magnolia. And then this coming Sunday morning, we're going to take a look at Joseph and Jesus, focusing on Luke chapter 2, verses 4 and 5. The children's musical that night, another great day in the Lord. I hope that you'll put forth a special effort to be present and to bring your friends and family members with you. Any other word before we bring the service to a close? If not, would you bow your hearts, please, before Jesus? And Brother Jason May, would you lead us, please, in this closing prayer?
Father, we thank you for the blessings of this day. Thank you, Lord, for our musical this morning, everyone who participated in it. We ask God that you continue to bless us. We ask God that you lead us, help us to show courage and kindness and love toward others. We ask God that we can always let your light shine through us.
Lord, bless.
Thank you.